Let's Talk podcast guests are invited to share their unique perspectives regarding diversity, equity, and inclusion. The ideas expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the practices of Mesquite ISD and are not an endorsement of any particular agenda or viewpoint.
Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast, inspired by Mesquite ISD's Leadership and Empowerment Team, or LET for short.
Our guests include educators, students, and community members sharing their experiences from their perspectives.
So let's have a real conversation about embracing our differences and finding common ground with your hosts, Dr. LaDonna Gulley and Ted Madden.
Welcome back to another episode of the Let's Talk podcast. We do one every week, and we'd love it if you would subscribe to the pod. And if you already do, and if you have a moment, please leave us a review, because good reviews and good ratings will make it easier for new listeners to find the podcast. We have a special guest today with decades of educational experience, and you'll be able to figure out just how many decades when he introduces himself, because this is how we do it. My name is Ted Madden. I'm a video producer for the school district, and I'm a 49-year-old white man.
And my name is Dr. LaDonna Gulley. I am the Director over Leadership and Empowerment for our district, and I'm a 52-year-old African-American woman.
Well, I'm Dawson Orr. I am a clinical professor at SMU in my 47th year of work in the field of education, and I am a 69-year-old white male.
Dr. Orr, could you take us through your professional experience? We were talking before the pod. You began your career in 1975.
I did. I actually began teaching at Baker High School in Columbus, Georgia, and it was the Muskogee County School District. They had a unified district there. It was approximately 3 years into integration in the Deep South, and so it was a challenging context. You know, we had kids who had been separated from each other by law and, you know, didn't really know and understand each other, and so It was a good place to start. It was hard work, but it launched me, and I really went to Muskogee County on a idea that I was going to do 1 year and go back to law school. And about 2 weeks into the year, I called my mom and dad and I said, I think I like this. I'm not sure that I might want to do this for a while. And 47 years later, I guess I did it for a while, mm-hmm. right?
And what did they say when you told them that?
Well, my father had been a teacher, my mother a teacher. My father was dean of the College of Education at the University of Alabama, so I think he was actually very pleased. He didn't try to talk me out of it at all.
I want to ask a follow-up from something you said about your days at Baker, and then maybe we can do it this way. As you go through your career and explain, your background, we can find interesting things to talk about. Because, 75, integration, you're 3 years into integration. You said the kids had to learn how to understand each other, mm-hmm. but the educators had to learn how to understand other educators and those black students. And you were right in the middle of it.
Absolutely. And the thing that I do remember is, my perspective, unfortunately, is that in integration in the Deep South, the African-American community bore the burden of it. And what I mean by that is the previously all-black high schools had been closed. And so, I remember Mrs. Childs, a tremendous English teacher who had been department chair for probably more than a decade at her high school, was now teaching ninth grade English and not in a leadership position. And, just all of those changes were dramatic, but the faculty made an effort to model for the kids, what it meant to work together. And, it was successful. I think the other thing that probably helped in Muskogee County is that it was a military town. Fort Benning was there. And so, you had Vietnam war brides, you had German war brides from, 30 years earlier. And so it was, in that sense, it was cosmopolitan, not in terms of sophistication, but there was a lot of diversity within the community, and it helped.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'm really, it's so funny, I was just in Columbus.
Oh, were
because
you?
My nephew graduated from Fort Benning from infantry in January, and I was really just struck by the community and just the city overall, and particularly the base. Mm-hmm. In terms of what it looked like and how everything kind of functioned. I was really, really just impressed with it. And you mentioned integration. Mm-hmm. I think that there has been lately lots of discussion about and debate about integration mm-hmm. as opposed to inclusivity. Mm-hmm. So, you know, during that time, we were fighting to integrate. But should we have probably been looking a little closer and saying maybe we need to just be more inclusive?
I think it would have been helpful. I mean, it was, you know, it was definitely under legal mandate. There wasn't there wasn't a deliberate sense of effort to educate, to bring people together. I mean, it was in compliance with a court order, you know, and so it was kind of left to the educators to figure out how to make it all work. And you know, I think people did their absolute best. But I do remember it was difficult times. I mean, the male teachers reported an hour, 15 hour, 30 minutes before the start of school. And we were in the parking lots and we were doing patrol because we had to be very conscious of kids will be kids, right?
Yeah.
And if they wanted to, like, establish who was in charge, they tended to do it in ways that weren't productive. So we had to, you know, be there and do what needed to be done. But it, you know, it went well. And, you know, from there, I taught social studies, history, government, but I had an innovative principal who had us on a 9-week Quinmester curriculum. So I ended up teaching a sociology unit on the family, which as a 22-year-old white male was kind of silly. But I did the best that I could. And then followed that principal when he was chosen to open up a new high school there in Columbus, Georgia. And then to kind of go, where did it go from there? I was born in Colombia, South America. My father and mother went overseas and operated. My dad was the director of a school for Standard Oil of New Jersey. They had an oil field in Colombia, and of course, in that time, all the families relocated. So he did that and was fourth-time personnel administrator for them. My mom taught for a couple of years, but I was born there. And so it was Colombia, Mexico, and then Guatemala. And I moved to the States when I was 11 years old. Mm-hmm. And my father went to the University of Alabama, where he had a long career. But one of the things that I do remember, and there is a point to this story, is that my father became very much an advocate for the power of the American school overseas to be a representation of democracy, and that democracy would work. And so that became his area of study as a university professor, then as a dean. He started programs in Colombia where schools, American school personnel there could get their master's and even their doctorates in educational leadership to support that work. But what I do remember in moving back to the States as an 11-year-old, when we were overseas, I mean, every 4th of July, we met at the school. The entire American expat mm-hmm. community would meet there, and we celebrated. And candidly, I realized when I moved back that I knew a whole lot more about American history than the kids that had lived in the States their entire life. Because, like I said, like, Dad, are we going to go up to the school? And no, everyone's like going out to the lake, they're partying, they're doing everything but really celebrating the 4th of July, mm-hmm. you know, and those sort of things. And so that's always something that stayed with me, is my dad's belief in the power of schools to represent democracy and to, you know, contribute to it. And it had a big influence on me, mm-hmm. you know.
I want to continue on your professional journey because I know you spent a couple of years teaching and being a principal at a school in Veracruz, Mexico. I know you were eventually a superintendent at Highland Park and currently a professor at SMU. So let's finish that journey.
Well, after my third year as an assistant principal in Columbus, Georgia, my wife and I married, very happy, didn't have kids. And I said, you know, Carol, I have wonderful memories of growing up in Latin America and, you know, being part of an American school. And there was an opportunity to go back to Mexico and do that. The Mexican government was building a nuclear power plant outside of Veracruz. It was the first in Mexico. And so you had Brown and Root, Abasco, General Electric were there doing the construction. It was a technology transfer program where every skilled position that was the foreign hire was paired with a Mexican counterpart, so they would be able to then build their own nuclear industry from there. And we had, gosh, engineers and, you know, just some of the top minds in Mexico and in the world from, you know, Mexico, the United States, Spain, India, Pakistani, Denmark. I mean, it was truly an international community. And after 2 years as kind of the elementary principal, then I became the director técnico, technical director, means headmaster, head of schools, and did that for 3 years. And by the time I left, we had 800 kids, K through 8, and it was unique in that we had the children of really like the maintenance workers and the children of the most highly educated scientists, physicists, nuclear engineers in Mexico in the same school together. And Mexico is a stratified society. That was very unusual. We operated an American school within a school because the American kids wouldn't really be there long enough to truly become bilingual. They tended to be there like a year or two. So it was interesting. It was wild. I mean, inflation got – when oil collapsed, inflation and devaluation started occurring at 100% rate, you know. So after about 5 years, you know, it just was like we could live well if we were just living on a peso economy, but it was kind of hard to see how I would send kids to college and do those things that you do. So I came back. My transition to the United States was back at the University of Texas. My father, as dean of the College of Education at Alabama, had placed doctoral interns with Nolan Estes, who was the superintendent of Dallas, yes, and with Billy Reagan, the superintendent of Houston. And he said, you know, Dawson, you need to look at the University of Texas. Nolan Estes is a strong leader. You know, he had been not only superintendent of Dallas, he'd been undersecretary of education with LBJ. So, you know, I went there, and Nolan Estes was a huge, huge influence on my life. And he called and he said, there's a new superintendent in Pampa, Texas. He needs a leadership workshop. And we had, as part of our program at UT, had worked with the IDA Kettering Foundation on school improvement. So I go up to Pampa, do a, you know, 3-day team building for a new superintendent and his entire cabinet and principals. And he invited me back and back to do other things and offered me a job. And as I told everyone, I was a full-time student. I'd saved enough money overseas to be at UT as a full-time student, but my children were eating more and more, and my bank account was going down rather rapidly. So I took the job as assistant superintendent in Pampa. Harry Griffith was the superintendent there. He was hired as the superintendent of Goose Creek. The school board offered me that job on my birthday, July 24th of 1990. And, you know, I took that job and spent 13 years as superintendent in Pampa. Wow. And people, you know, said, well, why that? Well, first of all, I felt like I was making a difference. You know, it was a small enough community. By the time I had been superintendent for not very many years, I knew all 500 employees by name. I knew who they were, and, you know, that was important to me. Mm-hmm. And then candidly, you know, I'd already lost my dad when I came back to the States, and my mother passed away, other maternal grandmother passed away, you know, and so I wanted my kids to have some sense of stability because they didn't really have extended family, so I wanted them to be from somewhere. And so had no regrets on that. Youngest daughter graduated, and I went to Wichita Falls as superintendent for 6 years. I enjoyed that. It had some complexity. It was three high schools plus an alternative school. And they had, you know, like the newest, they had one elementary school that had been built in like the last 20 years, you know. And think about the size of Mesquite, roughly 33 elementaries, mm-hmm, maybe more. Well, Wichita Falls with 15,000 had 32 elementaries. You know, some of them like 90-year-old buildings with 200 kids in them. And so, you know, we had to get some economy of scale. Mm-hmm. But I do want to tell a story about Wichita Falls. They had lost a bond issue before I got there, first one they had ever lost, and they lost convincingly. As they said, you know, people lined up in the snow in February to vote no, you know, and then, and, you know, it was a shock to the school board, and the superintendent took a new job out of state when I was hired. And so the facility was a big concern. Mm-hmm. So we worked very hard to put together a bond package and address the needs. And there were tons of just safety and infrastructure things that just needed to be done. And we ended up, and again, you know, like 14,000 people voted. And this is in a school bond, and that's a huge number for a community of 100,000. I mean, Frisco was passing $300 million bond issues with 3,000 people voting, and our 68 million went down by 252 votes out of that, like 13 or 14,000. And there is a point to this story. When we looked at the voting, the historically African-American portion of that town, there was one precinct, 500 votes, 498 no's, two yeses. And what it reflected is that when integration came to Wichita Falls under the court order, they shut down virtually all of the African-American schools in that part and bused the kids in. They had just built a brand new high school. It had been open for 2 years. It became an elementary school. Everything else was shut down. And what do you think happened? That part of town withered. Was it, you know, and it lots of abandoned homes and buildings. And so really it was the hurt from a generation before still carrying over. So I embarked on I told the board, we're not going back out. We're going to listen and learn. And we took, like, I took a year. I announced a listening tour, and I announced open door, come in. And so this is kind of the story I wanted to tell. Washington Jackson Elementary School, built in that previously new high school, elementary. So we, you know, back in those, we still had the little Friday packets where all the kids take home their manila envelope that's been decorated with the announcements. And so announced to the parents, this went out to the parents, you know, little, you know, superintendents come out, visit, listening tour about, you know, the facilities and needs. And I show up at that high school cafeteria, quote, elementary school, but it's a high school cafeteria, and it's filled. And it's filled with people with white hair. It was the generation of teachers, administrators, parents who had lived through that experience. Mm. And it was tough. I mean, I sat up there for basically like an hour and a half. And I do remember thinking Mother Teresa's famous quote about, I know the Lord doesn't give you more than you're capable of, but sometimes I wish he didn't have so much confidence in me. Because there was just really, it was tough, you know, and just that hurt. And I couldn't promise them. I mean, what they wanted was build a school, give us back our school, but there were no children there. You know, there was no way to do that. And so I just had to say, you know, I understand, and I'm hearing, and, you know, we're going to work to try to find a way to support, but I can't tell you that we're going to build a school where there are no kids, you know. We eventually were able to take a school that was going to be closed down, and we turned it into an early start center so that we could, for the kids that were there, get them into school even earlier and give them more support, and were able to recognize, you know, some of the historic leadership that had been part of that community. And we were able to get back out, and we successfully passed, you know, a bond issue to do what needed to be done. And we shut down a bunch of old schools and opened up some new ones. But I always, and Wichita Falls was complicated. They had been under, their court order had been based off choice with these rich magnet programs. So all the middle schools and high schools were open enrollment. You went through a process of, you know, choice. When it was under a court order, there were bands that controlled it. When the court took them out from under it, the school board, prior to my arrival, you know, just kind of went with an open choice. So you were always kind of fighting a bit of a tendency to resegregate, mm-hmm. you know, sort of thing. Got a call from a consultant to please, would you please come and talk to the Highland Park Board, apply for it. And, you know, give credit where credit's due. The Highland Park Board really caught my attention. When I walked into the room, the board president said, you know, Dr. Orr, we appreciate you being here. There's no doubt that Highland Park is our focus and our concern, but you need to understand that we are supportive of all kids in Texas having a high-quality education. And that's not the image that people, you know, had. And so that, you know, as your generation says, I leaned in a little bit that point. You know, it ended up being a really productive, you know, 6 years there. Mm-hmm. And then I had, in the course of working in Highland Park, had made a connection with Dean Chard at SMU. He had supported me in providing teacher, staff development, professional learning around the notion of global competency. Because my view of Highland Park and what I told the parents and community is there's no doubt your kids are leaders. You know, there's lots of evidence of that, lots of opportunities for it, but the world they're living in is not going to be the world that they're going to be asked to live in. And because, you know, they all talked about the bubble. Mm-hmm. That wasn't my term. That was their term. So I talked about the importance of you know, global competency and understanding and those sort of things. And they supported that. So I asked Dean Chard for support in training the teachers, because if the teachers couldn't help the students if they didn't have a sense of what does it mean to be globally competent yourself. So that connection with Dean Chard led to then they were ready to launch a doctoral program to prepare school district leaders, the EDD with superintendency certification. And I was happy in Highland Park, but in all honesty, it was kind of like, okay, I'm 62. When will you have another chance to be in on the ground floor of launching a new, you know, a new program to prepare school leaders? So that just was a pull that I went for and, you know, went in as the coordinator of, well, I actually went in as department chair and then picked up the coordination directly of the EDD program 2 years later, and then gave up the department chair 2 years ago and just concentrated on my students. And now I'm ready to concentrate on two darling granddaughters. And my wife told me, Dawson, you failed retirement the first time. We need to try to do a better job with that 1 week off between being superintendent and being department chair. Didn't really feel like a retirement to her. So that's where we are.
Wow. Well, and of course, my hope is that I know you'll retire and mm-hmm. really retire, but definitely still mentor so many people that you've come across and that you've also really inspired to really be great leaders for students. When you talk about global competencies, mm-hmm. though, that really piqued my interest. Mm-hmm. Talk about those. What are those? What are the things that I think all of our students have to have now as they move yeah. into this next realm.
Yeah, and, you know, I think you could, in some ways, you could drop the term global and just really refer to what does it mean to be a really fully functioning, capable adult? Because mm-hmm. what we were wanting to do was to help people understand that, you know, there are diverse points of view. I mean, people grow up in distinct cultures and they're values and norms are shaped by that. And you know, the example that I used in talking to the Highland Park parents is that it will not be unusual, and it's not unusual now, that, you know, your son or daughter goes in to work for a corporation and the design work is being done in Italy and the financial center is in London and the production site is in China or Vietnam or Sri Lanka, and they're going to be expected to interact and collaborate with people from cultures that are different than their own. And so, you know, you have to kind of help people, you know, focus in on the importance of empathy, you know. And I really do believe that if you don't have empathy for people, and I've heard others, you know, say this, it's not original to me, but without empathy in a society, there's really not a basis for justice, right? If you really don't care about what happens to someone else, if you can't right. feel some of that, then why would you worry about those sort of things? So we tried to focus on the notion of understanding other cultures, the importance of empathy, of recognizing different points of view. And, you know, we did it in different ways. It, you know, we went to a badging system in our elementary school. So if like an elementary classroom could partner with another classroom in another part of the world and do an exchange. And so we had like a third grade teacher, they, you know, in third grade you teach, it's like, you know, social studies, it's family, community, all those mm-hmm. little sort of things. So they decided to use art as the medium. So all of the kids in both schools, I'm going to say Eastern Europe, I'm not sure on the details of that, but they all had a little square that, you know, captured some aspect of their community, and they painted it, and we exchanged it, and, you know, we were able to take advantage of, you know, telecommunications and do some face-to-faces. What we did find, just like practically, it was a whole lot easier if your class-to-class exchanges ran north-south instead of east-west because of the time zone differences. So, you know, like Spanish AP class partnering with a classroom in Argentina was fairly easy. Trying to partner with, you know, kids in the Far East was like, well, it's, you know, 3 a.m. there and it's
right.
not 3 a.m. here, you know, but we, you know, we were able to do some things like that. And just continued to build the capacity of teachers to support kids in those things.
After a long career in education, I want you to talk about the importance of public education
yeah.
because I think it's largely taken for granted now, right? We hear a lot of criticism of public educators and of public education. And I think it's a good reminder as to why it's important and what function it serves in our society.
Yeah. Well, I think in simple terms, I mean, I think it's really in some ways the glue that is going to hold a society together. You know, if you – it's, you know, whether – you know, there were certainly limitations to Thomas Jefferson's call for education. I mean, he still kind of thought of it as for the aristocracy. But, you know, in his works was the notion of that you have to prepare people for a democratic society, you know, for self-governance.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't do that through a public venue, then you really don't have the public voices there. And, you know, Ben Franklin was one of those and others that talked about we always have to, you know, remember that there's a contest between the common good and the particular interest, you know. And so I think we have to recognize that, you know, you think about communities today. In a lot of communities, there is no longer a local bank. You know, it's electronic, housed elsewhere. You have, you know, major retailers who all of the money they gather in is immediately transferred electronically out. You know, we've become so intertwined, you know, that there are not very many institutions left in a community where everyone needs to come together and learn to live and work with each other and collaborate with each other. And I think schools are that laboratory. And that's what inspired my dad. That's what he thought about when, you know, the American school in Monterey, where I went to school, it brought together all of the American community, but also, you know, Mexican nationals, other, you know, countries, diplomatic corps and business interest, and they learned about each other. And I still think that, you know, schools, yes, we have to prepare children to be economically competent, able to provide for themselves and their loved ones, but we also have to help them understand that democracy requires citizens to be engaged and involved and collaborate with each other and understand diverse points of view. And I think those are the two functions of school that a lot of times are always, they're in tension. You know, the educating for a democratic society, educating for economic productivity, you know, trying to kind of keep the notion of that there is a common good if we're going to be a thriving, healthy democracy.
And public education, I think, is a great example, right, of not only our democracy, but an indicator of how we're doing.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think one of the powerful things that we probably don't say enough to kids is to really, you know, is to like understand how much of what you're able to do is really is in some ways it's the result of the kindness of strangers. You know, people that don't know you, but I mean that they pay their taxes and they contribute and they support with the notion of we're providing for our common good, for our society. We're building up capacity for, you know, to have, you know, competent civil servants and people that can work and contribute and make a difference. So, yeah, I think schools are really the great laboratory. And if you don't have a common experience for citizens, then, you know, I worry about the bonds. You know, will they be strong enough, you know, to do that? So we've got work to do right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what is our work? Yeah. Because I think when we look at, there are so many things happening and there are so many things that are going on. And I think in a lot of ways we've become distracted in terms of where we should be when it comes to public education. Mm-hmm. The other thing is I think that, I'm hearing this, that there's like this undercurrent of, you know, the dismantling of public education. And so I think that we might have to have some reminders of mm-hmm. why it is so important, and why public education is really key to everything that we do. It is the foundation. When you hear, do you ever hear, I'm sure you do in your career, just this people wanting to dismantle it, or you hear, like, we always get the bad press. Yeah. Public schools never do enough. They, you know, I mean, we constantly hear that. We never hear about the great things that we're doing. And so, I mean, how do we as educators really counter that message?
Well, I think the key is that we need to do a really good job at educating kids. You know, I mean, and let them in some ways really be the standard bearers for what we do, mm-hmm. you know. And so if we're producing quality outcomes, you know, for our communities, I think that's really kind of an important baseline. But then I do think, and, you know, I want to give Mesquite credit. I mean, I'm embarrassed to say this, but I actually enjoy Mesquite board meetings. You know, and as a superintendent of 25 years, I can't always say that I loved every board meeting I was in. But what I do see in, like, the Mesquite board does a really good job of building a sense of community. Mm-hmm. I mean, just the recognition of the Apple core and the fact that it's done, and it's been being done for years, but honestly, it's like every board meeting I've been to, it's like the first time it's ever been done. Everyone is still enthusiastic. Families are there. You've got people out in the audience. There's always kids being recognized with lots of families out there. You know, a lot of times you walk into a board meeting and if you see that many people, you go, oh my gosh, this is going to be a rough one. You know, and no, it's a celebration of community and of accomplishment of kids. And I think that's important. So I think you have to celebrate the successes. I do think, one of the things we did, like in Highland Park, in trying to create that global competency, we worked really hard also on developing the profile of a learner, the profile of an educator, the profile of a district. And we made an effort in developing our profile of the learner. We had like a 45-member working team that included parents, community members, college professors, business leaders, and students as young as, like, we had a third grader. Now, she only made it for, like, the first hour of each meeting because then it was, like, her bedtime. But, you know, she did her part up through high school kids. But, you know, one of the things that we did in building that is we connected with graduates of Highland Park High School that were, like, 24, 25, and asked them, what needed to have been done differently? You know, what do we need to keep doing? What do we need to stop? What do we need to start? You know, kind of that kind of dialogue. And so I think schools do need to reach out to their own graduates and gather input and use that input and let it be known that they are using that feedback, that they, you know, if we ask for community input, if we ask for parent input, then we accept that we need to be willing to act on it. Yes. Not just, you know, reflexively you study it, and if you can't do it, you explain why you can't do it. But I do think continuing to stay connected to your communities and build their ownership of schools is really important. And I think, you know, I think Mesquite's done a good job of that.
I'm going to steal the question that LaDonna likes to frequently ask.
Okay.
And the question is, what gives you hope? And I'm generally pessimistic. I mean, you've mentioned democracy several times, that your dad studied democracy. I'm pessimistic about how that's going right now. I'm pessimistic about the wealth gap. Here in education, we are losing new applicants every year. Job fairs are sparse. It's hard to hire people. What gives you hope?
Well, I start with the fact that there are dedicated leaders out there who are making the sacrifice. You know, I mean, they're leading in really difficult times, and you know, they're not quitting. You know, they may be in a position where they have to relocate, but they're not giving up on the work, and they're going to continue doing the work. So I do think there's a generation of leaders, just as there have been other generations of leaders, that recognize that we are at an inflection point where we have to have leadership courage and do that. So, you know, in preparing, you know, and at SMU, despite its, you know, image as a wealthy private university, if you look at our teacher preparation programs and our principal preparation programs and our doctoral, we are working with students who work in urban districts, challenging districts, and their sense of compassion and commitment to the work is inspiring to me. So I do take hope from the leaders that I'm seeing that are, you know, even in the pandemic, I mean, you've got people that, you know, they're still committed to a doctoral program and they're doing quality work. Well, there's only so many hours in a day. So I kind of think, like, you know, apparently they can operate off 3 hours sleep for a 3-year period. I don't know how they do that.
We do.
Yeah, they do, right? So, I mean, I do see that. The other thing, and I don't want to be Pollyannish about it, but, you know, I think right now, I mean, I think the pandemic has, you know, certainly caused stress in our social institutions. But if you look historically and look at the data, the vast majority of the American population supports public education in their schools. I think I heard former President George Bush speak at a lecture at Tate, and he says, I firmly believe that democracies are self-correcting. And that our people, you know, will look at this context and realize that if they want to change it, the way that's going to change is when they get out and they vote. And they vote for leaders that are about solutions and, you know, about finding common ground in our society. And I took that as, you know, I was inspired by that. And I think there's a lot of truth to that. So I do believe that, you know, our society needs to examine where we are. And if people are really concerned, I mean, if you're concerned about, you know, teachers walking away from the profession, you know, part of the discussion needs to be, why is that happening? Mm-hmm. You know, if people are under assault, not being given an opportunity to be successful, or they are, you know, financially not able to, I mean, they have no time left for their family or their church or their community as a result of the workload. So, you know, I think there are some changes I would argue for, is that we need to start thinking about things like differentiated staffing. I mean, master teachers should be concentrating on planning really rich, engaging lessons, but I don't know that they need to also then be grading papers for 3 hours a night.
Right.
On top of that, you know? So little things that I could see happening is just like we understand the value of the paraprofessional or the teacher associate, the aide in a classroom. We certainly could find qualified people to train and ensure they understand confidentiality and privacy. Who could grade papers?
Mm-hmm.
And free up the talent of the educator and that educator, you know, just like the IB program, for years is a very rigorous program. Kids would produce work, the teacher would grade it, but then those papers were then sent off to third-party quality control graders as well to ensure that you were kind of meeting the standard. So, yeah, you might have that associate that grades papers, and then the master teacher samples on an ongoing basis, and the productivity would go up enormously. Mm-hmm. You know, so like allow people to fulfill their passion, which was to make a difference in the lives of kids. And, you know, at the secondary level, remember, there are still people like they're passionate not only about kids, they're passionate about their discipline. They believe that like there is a philosophy of history and there's a purpose to history that people need to know and understand, and political mm-hmm. science and, you know, the great science teachers will just wear you out with the scientific method. And if we would do more observation before we acted, you know, gather
yes.
data, form a hypothesis. I mean, they care about that.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to recognize that people need an opportunity to convey that passion to their kids that they teach. And I think we're going to have to think about ways to support teachers to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And I do believe that, like, when kids go home, if kids go home and they're passionate and excited about what they learned, I mean, their parents are happy,
yeah.
right? I mean,
yep.
that's the litmus test.
Absolutely.
Right?
So what's the next innovation in public education?
Well, I think it's going to have to, in some ways, tap into the power of technology, you know? And, I mean, if you want to look on an outcome of the pandemic is it did certainly teach us that technology can be used in different ways. So I don't know if it's the next innovation. I always admired some of the small rural schools out in West Texas. You know, I mean, Pampa was a big district. We had 4,200 kids. We were a big district, right? There's some little tiny districts there. They figured out a long time ago, like they couldn't all afford a good physics teacher, but one of them could. And then they would use, you know, telecommunication, TV, instructional TV to share that resource. And another school had the foreign language teacher. And so I do think we need to find ways to tap in and find ways to bring exceptional talent into schools. And I think technology might allow us to do that in some ways, give people more flexibility. So I think, you know, technology is a big part of it. I not going to go too much into the, you know, the political phase. Texas has some unique laws. I'm concerned, you know, about lots of things. But, you know, one thing that I think is just contrary to good education is when the legislature said that, you know, kids basically can't do service learning. You know, they can't do projects where they're actually advocating for
yeah.
something out. And, you know, I've always thought, like, whoa, that's part of preparing people for citizenship, isn't it? Giving them an opportunity to, like, something they care about.
Mm-hmm.
And so I do think personalized learning, project-based learning, problem-based learning, mm-hmm. and things that connect kids as they are age-appropriate, as they're ready, connect them into the communities where their kids want to solve real problems. They are idealistic. They're passionate. They care about that stuff. They want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we need to think deeply about that. Then next big innovation, I don't know if it's a big innovation or not, we have got to quit trying to teach everything in the world. You know, the mile wide, inch deep curriculum isn't serving kids well. We need to hone in on, like, really what are the power standards in social studies, in science and math, and take kids deeper. Because if you really build, like, if you really build a kid's competence in the scientific method, he or she will go learn the other stuff they need to do in order to solve something they care about. Yep. You know, but if you, like, the science standards. I remember a fifth grade teacher in Highland Park that she, I asked her and her principal to come down and testify with me before the legislature. And she said, you know, I teach, and she's teaching fifth grade, so those are 10-year-olds, right? Think about a 10-year-old, like where they are in terms of just their abstract thinking, concrete thinking, all that. She taught the solar system in order to cover all of the curriculum. She taught the solar system in one 45-minute lesson. Now tell me what kids are going to remember about that, you know? And she talked about how she would teach it if she were given the opportunity.
No.
You know, like the school would become the model and help kids conceptualize this BB at the end of the hall, go all the way out to the edge of the property, and that's just one distance in mm-hmm. the solar system. I mean, wow. And like, then kids go like, wow. Mm-hmm. But as it is, what do they look at, a little piece of paper, and it's like, we got the rings and we got that. Well, that doesn't move anyone, you
that's
know?
Right.
And so we've got to, if we want kids to be passionate about learning, and then we need to give them the rich opportunities to really go deep,
yeah,
understand something.
Well, that's Dr. Dawson Orr, clinical professor at SMU, and I think we got a lot out of your, what did we say, 47 years in education?
Yes.
Yes, indeed.
I want to say thank you so much, Dr. Orr, for being just a great human. And
oh.
I think it really, no, really exemplifying yeah. I think what every educator is hoping for, which is to bring about a positive change and inspiring students to be the best that they can be every single day. When you stop and you think about the thousands of children that you have impacted, either directly or indirectly, wow, what a great life.
Well, it's been great. And I would just say this, is that for all of the scar tissue that you may build up
yes.
as a school leader. I, you know, what I loved about the work is that I never questioned the purpose of it. I think of education as it's a noble profession. Your work makes a difference. And my dad always told me, son, you know, if you can't live with ambiguity and accept delayed gratification, don't go into school leadership, right? Because we do. I mean, we act out of faith mm-hmm. and a sense of promise that and we don't know what some of those great things children are going to do, but we invested in them, right?
Absolutely.
And that's pretty exciting.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. It's been a pleasure.
If you have questions for Dr. Gulley or me, the best way to reach us is via email, letstalk@mesquiteisd.org. You can find us on social media using the search term LETMISD. And please like or share us on social, and that'll help grow the podcast. And if you listen on the podcast app, please subscribe and leave us a review. Thanks as always for listening. For Dr. LaDonna Gulley, I'm Ted Madden. Let's talk again next week.